Okay, so welcome shareholders, of course, and I hope prospective shareholders to today's investor update on Race Oncology. I should remind you upfront, we're in the oncology business, but equally and uniquely perhaps, we're in the business of also protecting the heart, and I'll say more about that because that's one of the unique opportunities that we've recently discovered and that we're particularly excited about. The usual disclaimers, which I won't read, but for our collective benefit. I'll start with a corporate snapshot. 160 million shares on issue. We've got a 20.6 million option base out there. That's predominantly due to a bonus option that we issue to holders. It expires on the 16th of May. It's got a strike price of $4.50. So it's obviously well out of the money today, but should it come in, should that number come in by mid-May, of course, we would have the opportunity to raise significant capital. But that said, and it's worth noting our cash position of $37 million. We raised cash late last year. We did that through an SPP, and I should thank shareholders, many of you who may be online today, for supporting us. It was designed to raise cash against a very specific strategy, our three-pillar strategy, three distinct fundraising targets that were fully supported. So thank you again for your support, and we'll talk today about some of those programs that we're implementing as a result. Significant shareholders, our chair, Dr. John Cullity, but our largest shareholder, Dr. Daniel Tillett. Daniel will be available for Q&A in 12 or so minutes as we get through this section up front. Equally, I should mention Merchant Opportunities Fund out of Perth have been a long-term holder and supporter and continue to be so at circa 5%. It's, I think, important that I start by highlighting the investment thesis, and I'll talk about, frankly, where we were and where we're now, because we are today a very different company than we were. Traditionally, we're known to some as an AML, acute myeloid leukemia-focused company, with a legacy chemotherapeutic drug called Bizantrine, or trade name Xantrine. What's important about our history and what's great about our history is that our drug has been in over 1,500 patients and in over 40 clinical trials. So we know a lot about our drug. Our drug's being manufactured. It's being registered, in fact, historically in France, although never commercialized. But that history means that we're able to move forward very quickly. We understand the safety, the profile of our drug, and it's enormously helpful going forward. But what's more important, frankly, is that we've got a new strategy. That new strategy builds on our AML past, but importantly on two significant commercial areas. The first and the largest going forward will be FTO inhibition, so the ability to inhibit a protein called FTO, and broadly to be able to do that in leukemias, in solid tumors, and also in checkpoint resistance. So that's a significant opportunity, and we'll talk about that. More recently, our cardiotoxicity credentials, which were known from our legacy AML focus, have now somewhat matured because we've understood that we can demonstrate cardioprotection in concert or in partnership with other anthracyclines. And again, I'll touch on that, but that is a significant opportunity going forward. So our ambition is that we'll take those two opportunities to a clinical proof of concept, and that would enable us to pursue significant transactional outcomes in 2 to 3 years. I will just say now, and you're welcome to question us later, why 2 to 3 years? Well, simply generating additional data will drive, I think through inflection points that the last bullet refers to, will drive valuation to a significantly higher level. And it's in our collective interest that we pursue transactions off a much higher share price. And we think that the opportunity, the data that will come, and the marketing that will happen will get us to that point. So it's not to say we won't be working on this. We'll be working on this year, and we are working on it. But we think the optimal outcome will be further out. The three-pillar strategy. We shared at our AGM late last year the new three-pillar strategy. The beauty of this strategy is that it's de-risked further our company, but it's equally broadened our opportunity, and it's identified opportunities for new IP or intellectual property. We're designing our program, our strategies, and the implementation of them to identify partnerships with pharma, but equally to pursue those pharma partnerships and the data that we'll generate towards a transactional outcome. So said simply, and I will move quickly given time, Xantrine, our current formulation, has significant opportunity. We're pursuing that in the extramedullary form of AML, and that's a pathway to regulatory approval. We've got a proof of principle FTO program, again, through the extramedullary AML program, through what we call Stratum 2, or a leg of that program, that will be in patients this year. We will be opening a US IND in 2022, which is very important to, frankly, how the market will view us, but equally to our development program for the USA. And we will pursue our cardioprotection program. All of those things are happening and will happen with our current drug. That said, we're seeking to improve our drug, and we call that Xantrine Optimized. So we're looking at new formulations that provide additional utility for patients. That specifically would look like an IV formulation that will better suit the application of our drug in solid tumors. We are looking at oral formulas, and we've got a number of different ways of pursuing that development. All of those things will generate IP and give us access to larger markets. And of course, because we've learned a lot about RNA targeting molecules through Byzantrine, we're equally open to opportunities that we may identify ourselves or in partnership with people we work with. I won't drag you in detail through the slide, but you're welcome to identify questions. I will highlight up top that the Pillar 1 programs are largely underway, and we're in the clinic right now in Israel in a combination Xantrine, fludarabine, and clofarabine trial right now in RR-AML. So that's underway right now. We hope to be reporting out on our first set of patients in the near term. Secondly, the EMD AML program will be a phase 1-2 program, and that will be underway this year as well. And we've got news on that coming up shortly. And we hope to complete additional work around cardioprotection that will take us into in vivo work and later clinical work. Xantrine Optimized, I touched on. I'll talk about melanoma and clear cell in a minute. And I won't have time today, but I'll mention that we are working on a companion diagnostic for the identification of FTO, which will better help us to identify optimal patients and improve outcomes. So, again, keeping an eye on time, FTO, and frankly, I'll say it's complex at the outset, but effectively, we're talking about the M6A RNA methylation process. We know that dysregulation of that process is a driver of cancer. We know that it's a driver of cancer across most many cancers. And in our case, we've identified that FTO, the protein that we target, is an important specific driver of oncology. And that's being identified by the City of Hope and also by the University of Chicago. So we know that FTO is an important protein to target. It's called an eraser, and there are writers and erasers, so they're called methyl groups. FTO is a demethylizer. So what we know is that through the City of Hope and the work they did, they tested, if you can believe, 260,000 drugs in the NCI, National Cancer Institute database. Of that 260,000 drugs, Byzantrine was the most potent inhibitor identified, and the City of Hope have taken that through preclinical work, and that work's been, again, as I mentioned, concurred on by the University of Chicago. So we have Xantrine as the first and best-in-class FTO inhibitor, and that's a significant opportunity because of what inhibiting FTO could do across not simply one tumor type, but potentially multiple tumor types in oncology. So for us to progress this, we ultimately need to demonstrate this understanding and proof of principle in patients. So our chosen cancers that we're pursuing are number one, melanoma. We've completed very positive preclinical work, and we've now progressed that work to animal work, and we'll be reporting on that animal work, frankly, in just a number of weeks, we hope. So with that animal work, and assuming it continues to reinforce our confidence in Xantrine and its ability to inhibit FTO, that potentially will take us into a proof of concept clinical trial program in the very near future. And again, we're funded to do that. Thank you to the shareholders. We reported, in fact, earlier this week on clear cell renal cell carcinoma. So again, that was a high opportunity target. We've identified in this most recent result a high level of synergy between Xantrine and a range of TKIs or anti-cancer anti-kidney cancer drug. So we need to translate that work into a proposed clinical program. Cardioprotection. I'll move from FTO to cardioprotection, our next significant opportunity. Said simply, anthracyclines or chemotherapy remains backbone therapy. It's been proven long-term. However, it comes with side effects, and those side effects, one of them, and a very significant one, is cardiotoxicity. So effectively, clinicians in treating patients across a number of oncology types use chemotherapy, but in the process are restricted around the maximum dose they can deliver, because at high doses, you can create cardiotoxic effects. And those effects, unfortunately, can often be what may take a patient to a negative place going forward. So you may solve the cancer, but create a difficult outcome on the cardio space. So we know from historical study that, and I'm talking about doxorubicin here, that treated patients, cardiotoxicity is well understood, well demonstrated, and it is a defined problem that currently is not yet addressed. So the only way to address it, and there are a couple of inhibitors, but none of them doing a great job. So the way to inhibit it is to use lower doses of chemotherapy. What we've demonstrated, if you look at the graph on the right, is that when you add bisantrene to doxorubicin, the most prescribed chemotherapy, what you can do is in fact rescue cells. So as you look at the graph on the right and you see that percentage rising, as you add bisantrene to doxorubicin, you are rescuing cardiomyocytes or cardiocells. So by doing that, potentially you are significantly improving not only the cancer effect, but equally the cardiotoxic effect. So noting we're almost on time, again, I won't take you through this chart, but I will say the cardiotoxicity is a significant opportunity. It's straightforward. It's one that is a significant clinical and patient need. And because we're looking not to radically change behavior, but simply to consider for clinicians the addition of xantrine to their current chemotherapeutic regimen. So we're now working through the in vitro and later animal work that will help us to demonstrate that and translate that shortly thereafter to the clinic. We're often asked the question, well, what's this all worth? And what I will say is that much of our work is early stage, but not all of it. We're in the clinic this year right now in Israel. We'll be in the clinic this year in Australia with EMD AML. So those are therapies that we can cost quite confidently. But FTO and cardio is preclinical. But when you look at global, and certainly this slide highlights some of the US deals that have taken place, many of them have happened preclinically. They've happened in the RNA space, and they're happening in areas where we have significant advantage, leadership, and opportunity.